Hey everybody, welcome back to Odin Sphere, and we have a new base of operations.
Oh man, we finally made it to Palookaville.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good Fat Boy Slim album. Newcomer,
I shall have you remember how I said Mirrors is like the most inorganic person ever?
Newcomer, I shall have you collect these coins.
Newcomer, this is gold. This is an aerial coin. I do gotta say though, Puka Village is like the coziest looking place I've ever seen in a video game, and I wouldn't mind living here. Or just, you know, going down here to get some lunch.
Man, it reminds me a lot of the town from the first Professor Layton game.
I have 12 matchsticks.
Fuck you! Ah, back in the good days of Penny Arcade.
Yeah. So I mentioned last time that we would be going to Valentine Capital, and we do eventually go there, but that's the last chapter. I just forgot. I just kind of brought it up early because it's the most prominent set piece in my mind.
For sure, but, you know. This Puka's got such a casual voice.
Yeah, this episode is all about a battle that's taking place just above the Puka Village, so that's what we're gonna deal with after we, get some eats.
Gotta do it, man. This is a Vanillaware game. Welcome. Hey, you're not my usual guy.
No, this was the first chef. Our guy is out in the field. We go here if we want to just, you know, pay money to get eats instead of, you know, provide the ingredients for ourselves.
Ah, I see. This is a much more standard business model. Whoa, look at that spread!
Mm-hmm. Seafood salad. Now, an interesting note, I think I mentioned this in Gwendolyn as well, so returning viewers might already know this, but, in the original game, for this, you had to both provide the money and the ingredients, which is, really frustrating.
Oh, yeah.
Here, though, we just have to pay. And, oh man, just paying for something like shrimp pepperoncino. And a lot of these we've already cooked before, so I'm just kind of fast-forwarding through the motions. Mostly.
He's so dignified when he eats.
Well, yes, he's been taught good table manners. He's a prince.
It's so good, man, because I remember Kisuke just like in Muramasa just tucking into the food like a pig in a trough. He was just like,
great.
Oh man.
Yeah, everybody has their own unique. Like, there's a body language to everyone eating. Like, all the princesses have kind of, you know, this very dignified and regal look, and same with Cornelius. But then you get to Oswald, he just has, like, he has one elbow on his knee, he has just the entire fork in his other hand, he just kind of shovels it in his mouth, doesn't even care.
I mean, I like how dignified Cornelius is, but he still clears this goddamn platter in two bites.
He's just like, I sure do enjoy the food, as he carries like half a steak in his hand. Oomph!
Oh, this is wonderful. I'm just gonna one-hand a banana cream pie like Frank West.
Oh man. I mean, it would be better if you just kinda shoved the whole pie in his face like Frank West.
He rolls up the entire plate.
Man, one thing I'm kind of disappointed in Dead Rising 2 is that they had unique animations for eating all the food. Because part of me wanted to see him eat, like, a can of soda for health.
Oh, heck yeah.
But I think that people would see that and be like, that ain't right.
That's like psychological warfare against the zombies.
I have a lot of food to catch up with, because Cornelius is technically under-leveled at this point. I mean, in a way, levels don't really matter because it's, heroic mode and HP doesn't really, come into play, but you still get stats as you level.
Sure. Man, 6 silver for egg on toast. That's ridiculous.
It's really good toast.
Better be fucking mystic toast.
It's bread we harvested from wheat born of the souls of the damned. 6 silver.
Oh, just like how I got my sword!
Yeah, it's interesting how blacksmithing in this game and farming share the same general idea of, yo, we're gonna take the souls of the damned and just put them to work.
I guess they use the the Farmville cosmology. It saps your soul, and then you're able to grow cows.
Sounds about right.
Yep.
Wait!
Oh, for God's sake, go away.
You should go back.
Oh, I hope you're ready for the most awkward line from Cornelius ever. I forgot about the scene.
I have told you about the cauldron.
Like, I mentioned before, all these scenes are just so stilted and bizarre, it almost doesn't feel like this is an actual script. But there's one line from Cornelius that everyone makes fun of.
Onto the battlefield alone, in order to stop it. I'm so nervous. Princess Velvet.
Why are you so concerned about Princess Velvet?
Because I'm her boyfriend!
I can't tell you now. In any case, the Aesir and the
Vanir
are nearby.
That's pretty bad. Altogether.
Yeah, like, I enjoy Cornelius' plot, but anything to do with Miris feels so bad. Because it's mainly a context dump.
King Valentine has returned.
It's not organic in any way.
The cauldron is still active, but it is like being asleep.
Just making sure that the idiot video game player is up to speed here.
Yeah.
This disaster, when this land was destroyed and its people.
We literally covered this a chapter ago.
What kind of king wishes for the destruction of his own country?
The cauldron ruined Valentine. That nightmare may become reality.
I believe
once
it's
again.
Coming up soon.
The only one able to stop King Valentine will be the princess. She knew him.
I have a magic sword. Don't worry about me.
That has nothing to do with anything, Cornelius.
Don't make fun of him. He's on the autism spectrum.
Oh, Velvet.
It's just so funny because she's going on about this whole thing about her kingdom being destroyed, and Cornelius is just like, I have a sword.
I don't know what you're talking about. That was a perfect segue.
The king has gone mad! I have a magic sword!
So yeah, we are going to... Probably one of my favorite levels just mainly from the framing. It doesn't become readily apparent, but even though there's a lot of asset reuse in this level, it's done in a clever way that makes things feel a lot more organic. Also, I don't have any skill points for any skills I want.
That's fine. You have a magic sword.
Yes. I'll be able to defend myself.
I can't leave that line alone.
No one can. Like, when I was recording these videos, I tweeted like, oh, one of the videos got glitched. Luckily it wasn't this one, and I had to like do a little bit of creative editing to fix it. And then immediately after they did that, somebody tweeted at me, I hope Cornelius' famous line is in there, and I just said, yes. Everybody loves that line, it's so bad.
I need to cut the video. Oh, no problem. I have a magic sword.
Here's my video editing sword. It's a purple sword with a P at the end of it.
Yep, that's right.
Blast! It's only a Sony Vegas! I'm doomed for sure!
Yeah, I don't know how people deal with Sony Vegas. I saw that UI and I was just like, nah.
What's better yet is if your magic sword is AVI synth, it's just a wooden plank that has editing written down on it in Sharpie.
I thought you were gonna say it's just a wooden plank with razor blades attached to it. By the way, we get Napples this episode.
I beg your pardon?
Napples.
They're Napples?
Just apples.
Oh, it's a little heart-shaped apple.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about a nasty apple, am I right? Whoa, 3 bites for a Napple, that's amazing.
Yeah, Napples are pretty good in general. They're good for just in general healing, even in normal mode. They give you a boatload of leveling for alchemy, and when you're done eating them, you can just throw them.
Sometimes, if I really need to pick me up in the middle of the day, I'll eat an apple.
Yeah, when I'm in the middle of sparring and I need energy to, you know, get by the training day, I'll just eat an apple.
Absolutely.
People wonder why I'm eating an apple in the middle of, like, kickboxing, but hey.
You just say, hang on, I have to eat. Oh, that's another let's play of this game. Never mind.
Yeah. I was going to say. Great segue. Way better than Magic Sword.
That's right. We got Magic Swords and we got Napples. What else do we need?
Yeah, one thing that I'm... that like, I haven't played this during this recording for about, like, 2 or 3 weeks. And I think by this recording, I realized that, if you're, like, up in someone's grill like I always am, Spark Bolt is actually kind of a liability because it starts a couple... it, like, starts a couple hundred pixels in front of Cornelius. Like, it starts at the end of his sword. And if you're up in someone's face, the Spark Bolt actually spawns beyond your target, missing entirely. Yeah.
You gotta watch that.
You'd think Cornelius would, you know, jam it inside the person in front of them and then fire the Spark Bolt, but eh. Tempest is an okay ability. When we use it, I'll spark some trivia about it, but I don't really use it that much. Mainly because it roots you in place and I don't like that.
Well, there's so many Pacypher skills.
Pacypher?
Pacypher skills.
I thought you were going to say Pfizer.
Oh, look, man. My pee is never silent.
That sounds like a problem, Skippy.
Nom. 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 What do you think of people who eat, who eat the entire apple?
I mean, a little bizarre to me, but I don't see why that's a problem.
Think it's the most hardcore thing I think that you could do.
Well, yeah, it's definitely something you could do, but I don't see it being any hard. I know a guy who actively chews on ice cubes and popcorn kernels, and I look at them like, are you fucking nuts, dude?
See, I mean, that's really hardcore. That just says to me that that's somebody that you don't want to mess with.
Yeah. I don't think there's anything in particular here. You mainly get resupplied with seeds and eggs here.
Yeah, seeds are fine. The more Napple seeds, the better.
Yeah, one thing that kind of weirds me out in this new version of the game is that you're always in excess of seeds. Because I remember in the main game, I was always struggling to get stuff like Napples and the next plant off the ground, but in this game, I just can't seem to fucking get rid of them. And I always have trouble getting Rosemeal, of all things.
That'd be a pretty good problem to have, honestly, because you could always use your Phozons, Phazons, Orgone energy to level up, right?
Yeah.
You know, if you're not worrying about shunting them all up inside a seed.
So, that skill right there is pretty fucking good.
Lightning Saber.
We'll cover that later in the video, and for probably people I'm watching on YouTube, the part B. But
I have a lightning sword.
Don't worry about me, I'll be fine.
It's me, Cornelius. I have a lightning sword, and a fluffy tail, and I go hippity-hop!
So you know how I mentioned there's a lot of asset reuse in this level?
Yep.
I didn't realize that at the time because I kind of forgot about this, but... let's fight the airship again.
Hey! Yeah, they repaired it. That's great. Good for them.
Yeah, it's the same fight as before, no real bells and whistles. However, there's this one slight caveat here in that I don't have a shield.
Oh. Well, you better. Ooh. Hey, what's up? What's up, weak-ass Berserker?
Yeah. I believe this was take 5 of this particular fight because the big problem with this fight in heroic mode is if you don't have a shield, there are so many moving parts that it's so hard to deal with. And we're at the point in the game where a single stray shot can and possibly will kill you.
Luckily, there's Corny's Panicked Potion Storm.
Mm-hmm. He just, you know, freaks out and then just dumps his entire belt of potions.
Ah, jeez.
I like to imagine I like to imagine it's like a bandolier of belts on his chest, and whenever he just freaks out, he just takes out the belt and throws it.
Oh, yeah. And then he like, panics even further, and he starts throwing his, like, jar of juice.
Oh, no, I was gonna drink that. Now,
My milk!
I did luck out here. The only reason I won in this fight is because a cyclone potion and a turnip appeared. which is perfect timing for me to get shielding.
Nice, that's good.
I'm not above saying that this was entirely luck, because unlike Gwendolyn, Cornelius does not have a shopkeeper that sells him just straight up shield potions.
Yep.
Now, I think in this take, I don't do it because I was at the point of both frustration but needing to fucking complete this, but if you're just playing this regularly, you could just walk up to the cannon and slash at the flamethrower. Because while the flamethrower does actively aim for you, it still has a hitbox that you can hit. Oh, I do get frustrated here and just deal with it.
Ah, nice. That's good.
Unfortunately, you can't do that to the lightning conduit. Luckily, the lightning conduit isn't as bad. It's super predictable, so you know where it's going to come from. But with the flamethrower, you kind of want to get rid of that ASAP, because Jesus Christ, that thing just locks up a fight. Also, as this fight didn't get lucky enough, another cyclone and turnip spawned from dwarves that I killed.
Oh, that's excellent. Oh yeah, here we go.
Yeah, there are audio cues you want to look out for with the battleship, because they'll tell you what's going to happen. It's just kind of hard to tell, because alongside those audio cues are like 12 other explosions.
Oh, sure. Man, I really like the little Da Vinci air screw that these guys have.
Yeah, it's a pretty good design. Like, they definitely made it to where you could have a fucking air force with dwarves, and yet it doesn't look generic. Looks more like a prototype or just some kind of weird abomination of metal. Okay, bye.
Whoa!
Yeah, they could do that too. They could crash into you and explode.
Just crash it for fun.
Now, there's
hey,
one.
That's a lovely little touch. It remembers, you know, which balloon is broken.
Yeah.
Even though it changes the facing. That's, you know, it's so minor.
Wow, I didn't even notice that. I thought it just remembers that one is broken, but yeah. It's not a palette swap, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, that's, well, I guess artistic detail is pretty much the only thing these guys have going, so.
Now, for that fight, we got a unique accessory. We got the steel-toed boots. Well, they're not called steel-toed boots, they're called something different, but, this is a unique accessory in that it gives you minor defense up, but slows you down significantly. Well, not slows you down significantly, it reduces your jump height, sorry, because you're wearing steel-toed boots.
Right.
Now, why in God's name would we wear that?
Is there an area that requires somewhat precise platforming?
Nope. But there is a place that... There is a room that has a unique puzzle for that, which it's kind of a ho-hum thing, very minor, but I still think it's kind of neat. A nice little detail to put in this game to where it's just not, you know, run slash cook.
I look forward to seeing it.
In the meantime, casual gardening.
Of course. Hey, there you go.
Now, I believe with all fruits, the napple too, you can overgrow them to get, like, over-ripened apples.
So that they ferment on the vine so that raccoons can go eat them and get drunk?
Is that something that happens in real life? I don't know anything about raccoons.
Yeah, no, actually it's, I think it might be bonobos. It's some kind of small ape. We'll actually wait until certain fruits ferment, and then they eat them, and then they get drunk.
Huh, interesting. Animals are very clever. Like, they have a rudimentary idea about, you know, of alcoholism. That's weird.
It just goes to show you that, you know, two legs are four. Everyone likes to get a little fucked up on the weekends.
Two legs are four, it's 5 o'clock somewhere.
You're damn right, friend, you're damn right.
Oh man, I do enjoy that. I do enjoy Reverse Claw, it's so damn powerful.
It is.
I honestly feel like that's some kind of coding mistake. Because just being able to do either 1/4 to 1/2 in HP bars of damage. It seems a little nuts. Just in general.
Yeah. That never bothers me too much, because the way I see it, right, there's like a billion enemies in this game and only one Corny.
Yeah.
Well, that's just me rationalizing my love of cheating and also playing on easy mode. I'm a pig.
One little detail I do like about what they did with, I actually don't know if this is in the main game or not, but when... But unlike other characters, when Cornelius gets a critical hit, you do notice that his sword kind of powers up, like it gets a geyser effect going for it.
Yeah, yeah. A dragon key, how nice.
That is basically gateway gateway to progress.
Okay, so we needed to go here in order to finish.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think we could have avoided the airship fight. I'm not 100% sure, though. I think that was gating off this area. Now, an interesting thing I noted, I mentioned in a past video that the ice potion kind of goes in a linear fashion. Like, level 2 will get you 3 blocks, level 4 will get you 6 blocks, level 6 will get you 5 blocks. That's kind of not the case. It's actually level 7 will get you 5 blocks.
Mm.
And then level 9 will get you 6, but I've never made a level 9 ice potion, so I can't say for sure. Grow! I just want apples.
You can't rush a delicious napple, man.
Sure you can, you just gotta put enough souls in it.
That's right, you just yell at it until it sprouts. I'm not leaving, I have a magic sword.
Lord Brigand, that asshole, I kicked his butt!
You knocked off- is that the guy that you knocked off his nipple plates?
Yes.
Ha! Ha ha! I look forward to knocking his nipple plates off again, then!
Luckily, we're not gonna refight him again. This game is not that bad with asset reuse. Only once a chapter.
I'll make you a deal. Oh, will you? I thought you just said that you were war profiteering. You cockney shit.
Well, Cornelius has a magic sword right in front of this guy, so...
Of course. Better give me a good price on that fish fillet.
No, I do want that shield ring plus one, because, I don't think you can get that. Either that or I already have it. I honestly don't remember. But shield ring plus one is just better because it goes from, like, 5% chance to auto-block to 10. That's
really
good.
Oh, that's just great, man. He ripped that off of somebody's corpse.
Oh shit, you're right.
Yeah, yeah, that was looted off the dead. And then, he's like, alright, let me just knock this finger out of it.
Oh no, the finger's bloated, I got chop it off. Curses.
Blimey, he's just gnawing on it. Wait one minute, Gov.
Like, I was gonna say he's like the most wishy-washy businessman ever, but no, he's just a scumbag and knows when not to fuck around with people.
Yeah, 100%, man. He could see Cornelius's tiny furry brow just droop in anger at his war profiteering. Whoa!
Sorry, Maury.
You can call me Cornelius, you can call me the Puka Prince, but you better not call me late for dinner. Hacha!
That's a good skill to have.
Wow, that's great, man.
Everybody's just like, the war is going on, the war is terrible, watch out for the war. Maury's just like, got any leftovers? I can make something great.
He's like, hey man, how would you like some burrito and pancake pot pie?
That sounds hideous.
Oh, jeez, yeah, you're like, making stuff out of leftovers sounds really great, but you won't eat this, this burrito and pancake pot pie.
Like, burrito pancake can kind of work, maybe, if you try really hard, but then turning it into a pot pie,
Hell yeah, man. I had a whole bunch of mushroom soup left over. So who wants to come for dinner at my house?
Yeah, I trust your cooking. Better than mine.
That's right, I probably won't kill you.
Better than mine where I try to cook like fucking, try to cook Parmesan-coated chicken breast and then I overcook the chicken to where it feels like I'm chewing on rubber.
Oh yeah, you gotta watch that.
Chicken's a lot trickier. Here's Tempest, by the way. Now, an interesting thing to note, aside from like the goofy Cornelius spin that it does, that was actually an old move from Gwendolyn in the main game.
Oh yeah.
Like, she was one of two people that could cast Tornado just out of the gate. And for whatever reason, Cornelius just does it now. Still the funniest attack in this game, in my opinion, but...
Oh, it was worth it to hear those guys just going...
Yeah, if you want noise pollution, cast Tempest.
Of course, there's nothing like hit sounds to lull a Skippy Granola to sleep.
I think the worst culprit of that was, I think it was No More Heroes, because oftentimes people would just scream out, "My spleen."
Oh, yeah, totally.
Oftentimes in, like, a unified cacophony.
10,000 souls screaming about their spleens in agony.
My spleen! There's gotta be another game that's bad about that, but I'm just drawing a blank at the moment.
Oh, jeez, man. Yeah, there have been a few where enemies will all shout out at the same time, but they all have the same voice track. They're mostly bad games.
Yeah. There we go, Nullify 5.